As you heard earlier, I was at the trivia contest here last night. And some of the questions had to do with the Academy Awards. And from my point of view, it's a pity that the question did not include reference to the Academy Awards of 1960, which was incidentally the year in which I was born. It was a grand year for wonderful films, especially those in black and white. But one film in particular that, in my estimation, stood out and was snubbed by the Academy was a film called Inherit the Wind. This particular movie is a slightly fictionalized account of what was called the Scopes Trial, or the Monkey Trial, of 1925 in Dayton, Tennessee. The names were slightly altered and some of the facts were toyed with, but the essence of the story related the clash of the century involving three individuals, all with Illinois ties. There was John T. Scopes, school teacher, who was accused of teaching evolution contrary to the laws of the state. John Scopes was born in Kentucky, but he was raised in Salem, Illinois. Also hailing from Salem was another principal of this case, the Reverend William Jennings Bryant, who had run for president 5 times, served as Secretary of State under Woodrow Wilson, and was a grand orator and a universalist. He was very conservative in his universalism, and he was the prosecuting agent in that trial. It was his job to prove that John Scopes had broken the law and should be punished for teaching evolution, that from a universalist. And then there was Clarence Darrow. Clarence Darrow was a Unitarian, originally from Ohio, who resettled in Chicago and built his practice there. And he was hired by the ACLU to come to that small town to defend Scopes and to squash creationism in its cradle and to lift up and to defend a theory of evolution, which at that stage was nearly 50 years old, The Origin of Species having been published in 1859. There was another individual, you might say that he was Clarence Darrow's right-hand man, and that was the Reverend Charles Francis Potter. And Charles Francis Potter was a Unitarian minister who stirred up all kinds of troubles in the years immediately prior to the Scopes trial by publicly debating fundamentalist preachers on the topic of evolution and on the literalism of the Bible. And it was partly because of the trouble that Potter had stirred up in New York, and this was broadcast through the different media, including radio, to the other parts of the country, that the Scopes trial had to take place. It was seen as the great showdown between the forces of faith and the forces of science, and both sides were extremely confident. You may know that the fundamentalists celebrated a victory meal on the eve of the actual court trial. They were certain of victory because God, of course, was on their side. Many of these events are related in that film, Inherit the Wind. And that particular movie, based upon a play, takes its title from Proverbs, specifically Proverbs chapter 11, verse 29. The King James Version tells us, "He that troubleth his own house shall inherit the winds, and the fool shall be servant to the wise of heart." That trial, as I say, was 1925. Scopes was found guilty, fined $100. It was appealed, and the Supreme Court of Tennessee dismissed the indictment and the conviction on a technicality. Scopes later went on and to the University of Chicago, received a graduate degree in geology, and he had an interesting career in fields unrelated to teaching. The other principals, you can view the movie and see what happened, at least to Bryant. He died shortly after the trial. I find it intriguing that in this great divide, from 1925, which was showcased in 1960, a period of 35 years, Dan, which may have seemed like an instant, but those decades were a time of profound turmoil and change in the world, in the United States, and in the realm of religion. And I do not doubt that by 1960, it seemed to those making films, not only Inherit the Wind, but another film nominated for Academy Award, Elmer Gantry, that the age of fundamentalism had passed. Battle had been joined, and victory had been won. And that perhaps by 1960, they could enjoy their victory meal on the forces of science and reason. But just as in 1925 in Dayton, Tennessee, perhaps the victory meal of 1960 was a bit premature. Fast forward through the decades from 1960. Fundamentalism proved quite resilient. In an era of the 80s, I was in college, and I remember reading about court battles over creationism in school. Also, it began to be called intelligent design shortly thereafter. And how in different school districts battles were being waged, and how forces that were conservative and fundamentalist were very well organized and very tenacious and doing all the drudge work and fighting this battle on the picket lines, that is to say, in the school districts, and organizing to elect people to school boards so that school district by school district, they might turn the tide very, very slowly, very, very tenaciously. It was a brilliant strategic move. And we've seen in recent years how Texas has become one of the major battlegrounds, not the only, but an extremely important battleground for what is included and what is not included in school textbooks used by grammar school and high school students. You may have heard in the last year or two how Texas is the largest consumer of textbooks. And as Texas goes, the country will follow, because those who publish the textbooks will take their cue from Texas. And the forces that are fundamentalist are extremely well organized in that state and have incessantly, deliberately, tenaciously fought their fight so that the courts must become involved and scientists and theologians must continue to wage a war that we all thought was laid to rest in 1925. This is not the only battleground. It is not the only sphere. On a related note, I read somewhere that the number of individual teachers who are promoting creationism is on the rise, or at least they're strangely silent when it comes to the question of evolution. And in an article from December of 2010, this is a summary of a Gallup poll, it says 4 in 10 Americans believe in strict creationism. There's another article that says on evolution, biology teachers stray from the lesson plan, and this is from the New York Times, published February 7th, 2011. And it said, researchers found that only 28% of biology teachers consistently follow the recommendations of the National Research Council to describe straightforwardly the evidence for evolution and explain the ways in which it is a unifying theme in all of biology. At the other extreme, 13% explicitly advocate creationism and spend at least an hour of class time presenting it in a positive light. The tactic which has been used by the fundamentalist reminds me of the tactic used in the age of the Counter-Reformation. You may recall that when I was in school, I attended a Jesuit prep school, and one of the axioms that was shared with me is the Jesuit philosophy from the Counter-Reformation from the 17th century. And it was said then, and it holds true today, give me the child, and I'll give you the adult. Give me the child, and I'll give you the adult. And that is exactly the philosophy guiding the fundamentalists in this particular battle. And so if the 17th century was the era of the Counter-Reformation, the 20th and the 21st centuries are the age of the Counter-Enlightenment. Sad to say, they are much better organized than we. Sad to say, they learned their lessons, and they saved their victory dinners for a much later date, perhaps at the end of time, while we have feasted and divert ourselves to other pleasures and other concerns. But I believe that this is a very important concern. The issue is not also only being fought in the classroom. You will find it being fought in the legislative houses. You may know that there is such a thing as a museum, a biblical museum, that is in Arkansas, and that they're trying to build one in Tennessee. And that in the current biblical museum, and it's a massive, I believe it's 800-acre museum and grounds, gardens, etc., they have a fabulous display of biblical scenes, and it includes a reproduction of the ark, not full scale, that's being built right now. But the reproduction of the ark shows such creatures as Tyrannosaurus Rex being herded onto the ark 6,000 years ago, folks. And the website makes claim, or actually critics of the website who have actually been to this particular museum say that the museum claims that it was a vegetarian T-Rex. It's an issue because the taxpayers are being asked to foot the bill for much of the development of this park, and in particular a full-size replica of the Ark, which may be built in Arkansas or perhaps will be built in Tennessee. And the legislators and the governors of those states are vying for it because they sell it as jobs. We will create jobs, and therefore it is worthy of the taxpayers' money. These are bleak economic times. Jobs is a big issue. And it's easier to swallow that argument if you believe that jobs are going to be created and perhaps your family or your neighbor will benefit economically from it. And the people who have devised this legislation and have devised the other legislations understand how profoundly their theological views can be used in the public sphere, in the political sphere, and how it can challenge and change the economic sphere, which will then reinforce further political and theological development and create new legions of believers. And that, in fact, is what has been done and continues to be done in many states, in many districts, both legislative and school districts. And that is why 4 out of 10 Americans today believe in the literal interpretation of Genesis, that the world and all of its creatures were created in 6 days' time. The battle is far from over. And those who are joined in the battle from the liberal point of view are few and far between. I can think of many other subjects which are pressing, that have a much greater urgency in terms of war and poverty and so forth. But this battle, we ignore at our peril. There are those who will say that the Bible is the inerrant word of God, as if you could open up the covers and see written by God, edited by God, translated from Aramaic and Greek into English by God. Mercifully, those words do not exist. I'm fond of saying that Unitarian Universalists believe in salvation by literature. Well, they do too. But their literature is focused on one particular book and one particular translation. Their translation, their interpretations. And they would hoist this upon the larger society and build, as was said of old, a city upon a hill, a godly city, a city worthy of God's graces and all the blessings he has showered upon this particular nation, unlike any other nation in any other time. And they believe that. And they sing hymns and they pledge allegiance. And they are shrewd, intelligent people. And they are tenacious people. And they must be met with an equal dose of shrewdness and tenacity ere the battle be lost. I believe that there is much richness in Genesis and in the collection, the library that we call in English the Bible, the book. And we recognize it for what it is, a series of myths, history, poetry, propaganda, some stories which are very rich, some which are terrible. And I wish that the editors had expunged them thousands of years ago. It is an inspirational book, and it is one of the foundations of this civilization, and we ignore it at our peril. You may know that there are some Unitarian Universalists, most recently John Buren's, who was formerly a president of the denomination, who publish books on the Bible and biblical criticism, what's called the higher criticism, and who will look at the mythology of the Bible and the poetry and describe the history of how this library came to be, how it came to be written, collected, edited, and how it has layers and layers of richness as well as poverty within its pages. It's a story that I wish I could unpack for you, but time at this present moment does not permit. The situation is dire. As I say, it's not the only battle being fought. It's not the only battle that we could devote our resources, our energy. But I think we do ourselves and our children a disservice if we ignore the pages of Scripture from those traditions, and if we abandon it to the more fundamentalists, who would make it a literal document, word for word, and embrace only one particular interpretation. Never mind the tens of thousands of interpretations which are available, some which are backed up more by biblical scholars than others. But they will press their advantage, make no mistake about it, while there is a lull in the opposite camp. Once upon a time, I was in college. One of my friends was a fundamentalist, and I engaged him in a great debate, worthy of Clarence Darrow, if I say so myself. And in the space of about 45 minutes, I related the evolution of the universe and related how we are comprised of stardust. And I talked about the continents moving and about how the universe is ever-changing, and evolution promotes the idea that we and all life forms also change, sometimes for the better, but not necessarily. But that it is a universe in flux. And on the opposite view was the view that everything is static, as it was, it is, and ever shall be. And I can muster, and I did muster, a lot of information that I had digested. And I shared that information, as I say, in the space of about 3/4 of an hour, at the end of which he said, "You know what your problem is? You think too much." Now, those of you who know me know that when someone comes knocking on my door, whether it be a Mormon or a Jehovah's Witness, I will gladly let them in. And I will let them speak their mind and recite their lessons And then I will begin to try to show them the truth as I understand it. Unfortunately, conversation and dialogue breaks down, and conversation gives way to the attempt to convert rather than to converse. And we reach an impasse, which all too often happens. And because we know, if you've ever engaged in that kind of dialogue, that there will be an impasse and a painful silence, many of us shy away from those conversations. And I know that some of us have coworkers who will come and they will present their literature and their fundamentalism and challenge us to come and listen and to be filled with the Spirit, filled with the light. And we smile and we nod and we take it, and then when they're away, we crumple it up or put it in our desk or wherever. But we avoid those conversations because we don't have time for it. We don't have the energy for it. And perhaps your workplace is not the best place for these conversations. But I encourage you, be aware that they are foot soldiers in this great confrontation, and so are we. We are all foot soldiers in this confrontation. It's the confrontation of faith versus reason. And there is a counter-reformation going on as we speak against the Enlightenment, which is a movement which gave birth to this movement, Unitarian Universalism. So I'm drafting you all. When we have those conversations, be aware that it's not an easy conversation, and that some people will not be convinced no matter what evidence you can produce. So bless them and wish them well, but be prepared to fight them at the ballot box. And keep in mind the great wisdom from one of our own, more or less, Henry David Thoreau, who said, "If you have built your castles in the air, your work need not be lost. That is where they should be. Now, build the foundations under them." I do not doubt that if we work on those foundations, our castles, whether it's on evolution or many of the other values and ideas that we promote, will bear fruit, and that those castles will be firmly rooted, and that we will turn this tide, and that the forces of reason and wisdom will inherit the earth. And the alternative is that we will be left outside, and all we will have in our hands will be the wind which we have inherited.